name's John.
Hi, I'm Laura. Welcome to our lives.
Welcome to our lives. Excited you guys are getting ready to go back to school. That's kind of cool. Laura was just telling me about how excited she is to go back to school. but hope you guys are ready. Ready or not, here it comes. Can't wait to get back in here with everybody too. Tonight's going to be a chill night. And so hopefully you guys are watching or will watch later on tonight, or go out and find a friend and you guys will watch together. Anything else you want to tell them?
I'm good.
You good?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's pray and we'll get started. God, thank you for tonight. Thank you for the chance to come. And Father, just to spend a couple moments with each other, with you. Father, just worshiping you. And God, just pray that you help us to take to heart what we sing, what we hear tonight. And Father, just to let it be glorifying and honoring to you. God, as we look at spiritual disciplines, just pray that you help us to instill these as part of our lives, to draw closer to you. Father, we just pray that you be with us now, with the worship, with the scripture, and God, just you be glorified through all of it. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you are my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. My one defense. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. I worship his holy name. Sing like never before, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. I worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, I worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship your holy name. I worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name. Oh, I God, thank you for being a good, good father. God, thank you that even when life situations are not good, or when we're scared, or when we're anxious and we don't know what to do, God, we thank you that you are a good father because you know what's coming next. God, you love us through it. God, you give us strength, you give us peace, you give us courage. Whatever we need, you're always there. God, I thank you that even in times when times are scary and when times are uncertain, that you're there, and you're there in good times too. And God, I pray that even in those good moments, we wouldn't forget that you're the same God who gets us through the storms, and that we should worship you and rely on you just as much. God, thank you for being you. Thank you for being so good, so loving, so merciful, and so kind. God, and thank you for showering that on us. And God, I pray that we would use that and we would take that and we would show it to a world who so desperately needs it right now, God. God, we love you, we praise you, we thank you. God, I pray for John, and I pray that for him as he brings this message. God, I pray for these youth and for college students as they go into school next week or in the coming days or whenever they go back. God, I pray that your protection, that your peace, that your comfort would be on them. God, I pray that you would be with us teachers too. God, we love you, we praise you. In your name I pray, amen.
So school is getting ready to start back very, very soon. And I know some of you guys are excited about that. Some of you guys are a little nervous because it's going to be different. It's going to be something new this year. And as you guys are going back, I want to encourage you. We've been talking in here on Wednesday nights about spiritual disciplines. I want to encourage you with these two spiritual disciplines, especially tonight. But I want to just challenge you to really focus this year on making spiritual disciplines a part of your Christian life. Again, you know, sometimes I think, at least I do, I take for granted the fact that, like, I know one or two times a week I'm going to get together with the church and we're going to have a worship service and I'm going to get poured into and somebody's going to get to speak the Word of God to me and then I'm going to get to enjoy worship and you know, I'm going to have those things. And it's interesting that as all this stuff's been going on, I've realized that, like, man, if that's all you're counting on, is if you're counting on Wednesdays in here or Sundays in church or whatever, but you're not really digging into spiritual disciplines and training your life, it gets tough and it gets hard. And so I hope that you guys are taking these spiritual disciplines. I know last week the video may not have uploaded. I know for sure it's on YouTube. So after tonight, if you're watching on Facebook or Instagram, you can go to YouTube and watch it. It's on there from last week. Still working on trying to get Facebook and Instagram up. Definitely encourage you to do that. Last week, I know we talked about prayer and meditating on who God is. And so go back, watch that on YouTube. And then tonight we're going to talk about two that maybe for students, some of you guys are like, these really don't apply to me. This isn't something I can do now. But I think you can. And I think that not only can you, but I think you'll recognize a benefit in your life when you do this. The first one is fasting. And again, going to start out this week, just like every other week, and tell you that spiritual disciplines do not make you a better Christian. They don't make you more saved or less saved. This isn't a means of attaining salvation. This is simply a way for you to train and discipline your life so that your walk with Christ is enhanced. And so tonight we're going to look at the one called fasting. Fasting is when you withhold or abstain from something for a set amount of time. You know, a lot of people do it for Lent. You guys probably all have friends who do it for Lent or around Easter time. I know here in January we do 21 days of fasting and prayer. And it's interesting because when you go through, I went back and I was looking through Scripture, and I was trying to find the one place where God said, hey, listen, you need to fast. Hey, Israel or church, you need to fast. And it was interesting because I never found that spot where God speaks to humanity and says, in order for you to enhance your Christian life with me, you need to fast. It kind of started as a tradition or a practice. that people would do several times throughout the year, and they would do it for several times or several occasions. But what's interesting to me is all the different times and occasions that people did it, they were waiting on four different things from God, it had to do with God in these four different ways. The first one was they were waiting to receive something from God. Moses, right before he is given the Ten Commandments, he goes on the mountain, and he's praying and he's fasting, and he spends so much time up there without food or water. It's like he was waiting on God to give him something. Other places in Scripture you find this too. Before the disciples go out and start to preach the gospel in the book of Acts, they waited in a room, and when they were waiting in that room, they were waiting for God to go and do something in their lives, and they were waiting to receive the Holy Spirit from God. So the first time that, you know, fasting is good is if you and I are waiting to receive something from God. We're waiting to receive a confirmation, or we're waiting to receive an answer, or maybe we're just waiting to receive direction or where to go in life. That'd be a good time to fast. Another time would be they're mourning and they're waiting for God to intercede. You find this with David in the book of Psalms. When his child's sick, he goes and he mourns and he fasts until his child dies. But it's the idea that when someone is sick, or when we're waiting for God to intercede or to become involved in what's going on with what's our life, we would take a moment and we would fast. Another place is when you're waiting for, or you're mourning over sin, or as an act of repentance. Again, all the Psalms, all through Psalms and Lamentations, you find this a ton, where Israel or the king, whoever, somebody has sinned, and all of a sudden their eyes are opened up to their sin. And because their eyes are opened up to their sin, they take a moment and they fast, or they withstain, or like don't do something they usually do. Most of the time in Scripture, you find it's where they're eating, and they're fasting from food. The fourth one is when you're seeking God's direction, or you're seeking to know more about His character. Again, in the book of Acts, you find as the disciples, Paul and Barnabas, are getting ready to go out on a missionary journey. They take time and they pray and they fast. And so those are just different occasions where people fast in Scripture. And I think you can take those and you can say, okay, this is when I need to fast too. But there's some other stuff about fasting that I think is important. A lot of times people get the idea of fasting of, okay, I'm not going to do this. And it doesn't have to be food. It could be social media, which right now would be kind of hard because that would be church service for us. But it could be social media. It could be video games. It could be Netflix or Hulu. It could be I'm going to fast from Cokes or Dr. Pepper or Diet Coke or whatever. I'm going to fast from something. And a lot of times in our world today, like when people think of fasting, they think, oh, I'm going to give up something, and that's it. That's my fast, is I'm going to give this up. And that's true and that's good. But I think that every time in Scripture, when you see it, there's this complementary thing called fasting and prayer. In other words, they're giving something up, but they're giving that up in order to dig in or become more intentional about their time with God, to pursue God more. So in order to pursue God more, I'm going to do this. Again, I told you that a lot of times in Scripture, they did it with food. And so what they would do is they would fast, and then when they would get hungry, instead of going and eating, they would take that time and they would dig in and pursue God more. They would pursue His direction. They would pursue His intervention in their life for this person who was sick. Or they would dig in and say, all right, God, I need the answer to this. I'm waiting to receive this from You. God, I want to know You better. So during this time, every time I get hungry, I'm going to dig in further to You. And so for you and I, if we were to fast today, and you were to fast from social media, or you were to fast from Netflix, instead of just giving it up and saying, okay, I'm going to give this up for 20 days or 30 days or 5 days or even just for 2 days to start out with, instead of just saying, all right, I'm going to give this up and I'm not going to do it, I want to challenge you that while you give that up, that's great, but be intentional about taking the time that you would be doing whatever this was, social media, or anytime you want a Diet Coke, or you want a Coke, or anytime you want sweets, or you want to go watch Netflix, anytime you want to do that, instead of going and doing that, be intentional about pursuing God. Spend that time intentionally pursuing Him, intentionally having a conversation with Him. Last week, again, we talked about prayer, and we talked about different ways and how to pray and what to pray for and who to pray for. And so take that time, and instead of spending it doing this thing or that thing or whatever, or take it and be intentional about pursuing God, praying to God, studying God's word, reading God's word, do something different to where it's not just that you're giving something up and it's like this trophy or this achievement that I give something up. It's that you're pursuing God. A couple scriptures I want to share with you guys tonight. The first one's in Matthew chapter 6, verse 16. Jesus says this, "When you do fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others that they're fasting. Truly I tell you that they've received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head, wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." See, a lot of times, again, for us, it's about, I'm going to give this up for so many days, and it's this idea where we tell everybody, and I'm not saying don't tell people, because a lot of times you need help becoming accountable. And so if I'm going to fast from something, I need to tell my friends, hey, listen, I'm fasting from this, so that they can help keep me accountable. But it's this idea when Jesus gives it to us here, he says, listen, don't make it this show of I'm doing this so that you all see what I'm doing. He says, in other words, act as normally as you can. So if that's the case, then like don't make a big deal out of it. If you go out to a restaurant and you order water and everybody knows you usually drink Coke, don't tell your friends, oh, well, yeah, I'm fasting. Watch me. I'm super cool. Just say, yeah, you know, tonight I think I'm gonna stick with water. Not that you're trying to mislead or lie to people, but again, it's using that time to intentionally seek after God. And sometimes it becomes so much about the goal or the reward or the end result of I've fasted for so many days from this that we lose focus on that intentionality of pursuing God during that time. And so another question that, you know, probably comes up, for me anyways, this came up. When people talked about fasting and stuff, I was like, why do I need to fast? Like, you know, I was in high school. I didn't realize what fasting all was about. There's this awesome parable that Jesus tells in Luke chapter 18. He says this, Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, in a certain town, there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with a plea, "Grant me justice against my adversary." For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, "Even though I do not fear God or care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice, so she will eventually come and attack me." And the Lord said, "Listen to me." "Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you that he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?" In other words, you're like, that's kind of a weird story. What does that have to do with fasting? I think it's a story to you and I about the fact that it's the idea that you're willing to do something difficult. When you read back through this story, the reason the judge granted this widow's request wasn't because she had a good case, wasn't because he cared anything about her, or because he was a good judge. It was simply because the woman showed dedication. She showed this perseverance that said, I'm going to stick with coming and asking you every day, grant me justice, grant me justice, grant me justice. And finally, the judge says, all right, fine, like whatever it takes, just get away from me. I'll give you whatever you want. I just want to be done with you. And while we just sang the song, Good, Good Father, and I love that song, that's not God's mentality of just, here it is, you've bugged me enough about it, now get away from me. I think what that story shows us as Christians is this, is that sometimes God wants to see that we're willing to stick with something. He wants us to see that, like, we're going to set our mind to pursuing him for X number of days, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 30 days, whatever it is. And during that time, God wants to see that we are serious, or that we're willing to dedicate ourselves to pursuing after him. That's why we fast. That's why we should do it. It's not for a show. It's not so that God will be like, oh man, they fasted for 40 days. Let me go ahead and give them an A on this test or whatever the case is. But it's this idea that we're willing to be serious enough about our relationship with God that yes, we're giving something up, but for that time, instead of this, we're going to pursue God in a new and intense way. And that dedication is what God, that to me is what gets God's attention. And that's what makes God stand up and kind of say, all right, I'm glad that you're serious. I'm glad that you're dedicated. I'm glad that you're going to persevere, that you're going to keep going with it, that you're going to continue to stick through this. And so this year, as you guys are getting ready to go into school, I don't know, you know, given that this might be a new concept to some of you, I want to challenge you to take and just say, all right, I'm going to do one day or I'm going to do 2 days, depending on how often the thing that you're fasting from you usually have in your day. But I'm going to fast from this, be it social media, be it, you know, TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, be it YouTube or Facebook or video games or whatever it is that you're going to fast from, junk food for you know, 2 days, or sweet tea for Kelsey, that'd be a disaster. But like, you're going to fast from something for a couple days and be intentional about pursuing God during that time. And like I said, go back through that list again, waiting to receive something from God. You're mourning or you're wanting God to intercede in a certain way in your life. Maybe God, in the process of all this, is going to start to show you some stuff about your life that's not right, that's sin, and that you need to repent from. And so as part of your repentance and part of your acknowledging your sin before God, you're going to say, God, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to fast just to spend some more time intentionally pursuing you. Or maybe you need to spend some time just digging into the character of God, who God is. We sing songs all the time about how God is good and God is loving and he's a good father and he's all these different things. But some of us don't know that in our personal life. We don't know how to find that in Scripture. And we don't really know that those things are true of God. They're just things we've always heard about God. And so spend some time intentionally pursuing those different things during your fasting. The second spiritual discipline we're going to look at tonight is the idea of rest. And last year I was in... we've got our camp shirt on the wall over here. I wore it a ton this weekend, but it was pause and unwind. And our whole theme for summer camp last year was this idea of resting. And as I think back to last year's summer camp, but I went back through and was getting ready for this lesson, I'm amazed how many times this idea, this concept of rest comes up in Scripture. You find God doing it after creation. You find all through the Old Testament, prophets and the people of God and even the land that they worked as their farmland had these periods of rest that they would go through. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 3, and God blessed the seventh day and he declared it holy because it was the day that he rested from all his works. Over in Exodus, when Moses has given the Ten Commandments to the people, it says, remember and observe the Sabbath day and keep it holy. You have 6 days for your ordinary work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath day of rest dedicated to the Lord your God. And so during all this, I want to challenge you guys to take rest when you need it. In Psalms, David writes this. He said, my presence shall go with you, and I will give you rest. There's something so unique and so wonderful about rest that you spend intentionally with God. Now, how many of you guys have ever, like, taken a nap in the middle of the day and all of a sudden you woke up and it's like 3 o'clock in the morning and you don't feel good, you don't feel rested, you don't really feel that good? But then there are other days, I know for me, like, when summer camp and stuff like that, people always say, well, don't you get tired, blah, 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 whatever. And it's like, I really don't, because when I do get rest, it's with this intentionally mindset that I'm resting to prepare myself for whatever God's going to do next. In Scripture, that was the idea here. It's that when God created everything, he rested because then the next day, everything started fresh. His relationship with man became new. Everything was starting over again, and he was getting ready to do something else in the world. In the Gospels, you see it in Mark, it says this, "Then because so many people were coming and going, and they did not even have a chance to eat, Jesus said to his disciples, 'Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest.'" It was this idea that they were going to be with God to rest. They'd been so busy with everything that was going on. They were so busy with ministering to people and feeding people and bringing sick people to Jesus and all this different stuff. And Jesus says, "All right, listen, you need to rest also. You need to take some time where you just rest to prepare yourself for what God's bringing next." Again, school's coming up and school's starting back, and you're going to get to be around friends and people that you haven't been around for a long time. And I'm so excited for you guys. But man, I want to challenge you guys to go in rested. To go in rested from this mentality of a spiritual discipline, not go in sleeping 12 hours and having to wake up at 6 o'clock that first day for school, but going into it with this mindset: I'm going to take some time for me to spend some time with God so that whatever comes next, whatever school throws at me, whatever God gives me an opportunity to share his love with somebody or to be kind to somebody or to share the gospel with one of my friends at school, I'm going to be ready for it because I've rested and now I'm ready to move forward. Another reason I think rest is really important is because of this. A lot of us aren't at our best when we're not resting. In Peter, it talks about being of sober mind. And it's interesting that word sober a lot of times in our culture and in our world means don't drink, don't do drugs. But the original word there has a different context. It's anything that inhibits your mind. In other words, Peter knows, hey, listen, when you don't get enough rest, you're not at your best. And so all of a sudden you start to do things that are uncharacteristic or unlike you. Think about athletes, for those of you guys who play sports or in the band, the reason you go through summer workouts and training and you go through conditioning and you go through band camp and you do all these different things is so you train your body to where when you get tired, you still function and do what you know you're supposed to do. It's because when our bodies get tired, when our minds get tired, the tendency is to not do the things that we know we're supposed to do. When you and I get tired, it's easier for us to fall into sin. It's easier for us to say, well, somebody else will do this. God, I'm tired. I don't want to do this right now. It's easier for us to miss out on spiritual disciplines, on doing things we know we need to do in order to enhance our walk with Christ. And all those things happen when we get tired. It becomes so much easier for us to do that. And so rest is so important to us because it is a time when we can refresh our spirit for whatever God wants to do next. The idea of rest doesn't just stop there. In Hebrews chapter 4, it says this, "So there is a special rest still waiting for the people of God. For all who have entered into God's rest have rested from their labors, just as God did in creating the world. So let us do our best to enter into that rest." It's this special rest that comes only from God. See, a lot of us, again, can sleep for 14 hours or 12 hours or 10 hours or 8 hours or 3 hours and we feel rested. But there's this different type of rest when you're intentionally going into it with the mindset of, God, I'm going to unwind, I'm going to rest because I'm going to be ready for whatever you want me to do next. I want to clear my head. I want to get all this stuff out so that, God, I'm at my best. So that a world that needs to see you in me gets a really clear picture of it. That's the kind of idea that comes with this rest. It's this special rest that can only come from God because you're being intentional about setting this side of time to rest, to pull yourself away from things, and to become ready for what God wants to do in your life next. Now, what do you do during that time of rest? I don't know, listen to praise and worship music. Go back and watch old YouTube or Facebook videos that we've posted. Find a pastor somewhere that teaches something and just listen to that. Just listen to music. Go for a walk. Read your Bible. All these things can just be pulling it's the idea of pulling yourself out of your normal routine and being intentional about your time. I'm convinced that the biggest struggle that we face today is time. Man, there's never enough time. There's never seems to be the right amount of time. And time is a big, big struggle for us. And so I think what God wants from us, and that why these two spiritual disciplines stand out so strongly to me, both in fasting and in rest, is because it's just this moment to set aside the routine, to set aside all the things that you have to do, the places you have to go, all the stuff that's just screaming at you for your attention, and being intentional about taking a step back and saying, all right, God, during this time, it's me and you. God, I don't want anything else during this time. I'm going to shut my phone off. I'm going to turn the TV off. I'm going to do whatever it is. I'm going to put this up. I'm going to put that up. God, I just want to pour into you, and I want you to pour into me during this time. That's something that I think we all need. And a spiritual discipline that I encourage you guys, especially as school is coming back around, to really take some time and consider doing. To sit back and say, all right, I'm going to fast from something for a couple days, and while I'm fasting from it, anytime I want that or I want to do this activity or whatever the case is, instead I'm going to try and find a way that I can pursue a deeper relationship with God. And take some time to just pull back from everything that's going on and rest. And just say, all right, God, during this time, these 5 minutes, this 10 minutes, this 30 minutes, whatever it is, God, I just want to rest. I want to turn everything else off, and I just want it to be me and you. Because, God, I know you've got something big coming up, and I want to be ready for it, and I want to be the best me that I can be. I love you guys. Miss you guys. Cannot wait to see everybody again. Excited kind of for you guys to go back to school, because maybe I can get to your school and I can see you at your school. One of the announcements from last week that Tucker gave was, if you can please text me, leave in the DMs or message us or whatever on Facebook or Instagram, somehow send us something on Twitter or Snapchat with your address. We've got some back to school, like little goodie bags we want to give you guys just as you go back to school. Our way of kind of loving on you, since we don't get to do it in person, we want to do it through a goodie bag. So if you guys will send me your address or tell me where you want to drop your goodie bag off at, we've got goodie bags we want to get to each of you guys before school starts back or as school is starting back. And so make sure that you do that. Text me, call me, send it to us somehow on any of the social media platforms. We'd love to get you guys' address. Tucker announced that last week. But again, I don't know that any of you guys saw it because it didn't get uploaded onto Facebook or YouTube, but I love you guys. Let me pray for you. I'm going to pray for you as you go back to school. I'm going to pray for your teachers, and all the teachers and just everybody that's going back to school. And so, let's pray together. Father, thank you for today. Lord, thank you for, this concept of fasting and of resting. God, just two spiritual disciplines that stand out about our intentionality and God seeking after you. Father, I pray that these become things that we do weekly, daily. Father, that they are part of our everyday life. God, that there are times where we need to just pull back from everything and we need to be intentional about seeking after you. Father, I pray that as schools open back up, Father, I just pray a hedge of protection around the students, around the schools, around the teachers, around the faculty, the staff. God, everybody who's going to be working with students in their school systems, Father, I just pray that you protect them, that you keep them safe. Lord, that you help them to just enjoy school like it needs to be enjoyed. Father, to learn, to have all those benefits, but God, also just to do it in a safe manner. Father, I pray that you just give us wisdom as we look at what opening schools back up mean. Father, I just pray for those people who are making those decisions that you continue to guide them, direct them. Father, I can't wait till we can all come back in here together, but I know that you have a plan and a purpose through all this, and so God, we trust you with that. Father, I just pray that you help our students to be a light to a dark world as they go back to school this year, because they are rested and they're fed up and ready to go just share what you're doing in their life with the hope that you bring with so many people. Lord, we love you. We thank you for everything you do for us. We thank you for salvation through your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Love you guys. We'll see you soon.